see all your smiling faces there tonight.
Amen.
Would it be in your victorious hymns to begin with, number 171. If you find the hymnal, stand with me. We'll sing Standing on the Promises, number 171.
Father, we come to you this evening, Lord, thanking you, Lord, that we can stand on your promises, Heavenly Father, and that what you have said will come true, that you change not, Lord, and just praise you for that. Praise you also, Heavenly Father, for your righteousness, Heavenly Father, and that whatever your decisions is made, it will be made right, Lord, and that in our life, Heavenly Father, just pray that you would continue to direct us and continue to woo us. And Father, just lead and guide and direct in the way that you would have us to go. And Father, may you give us a willing and a heart to follow. Lord, just praise you for your healing power too, Lord, those around about us that are sick, Lord, in your churches, Heavenly Father. Just pray that you would bless them and recover them from their illnesses, Father. Father, also pray that we're looking forward to your return and coming in the clouds of glory. And thank you, Lord, for sending your Son to die on the cross of Calvary, that the shedding of that wonderful blood, that we can look forward to the future, Heavenly Father, that you have cleansed us from all of our unrighteousness. Father, just thank you for that there too. Thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to be able to come to your house tonight and to listen to the words that you have put before Brother Nils, Lord, and just pray that you would bless those words and the Spirit would take them, Father, and that we would change and we look at our lives, Heavenly Father, and compare it to it. And Lord, we would be willing to make these changes, Heavenly Father, because we love you for all what you've done for us. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
You may be seated. Number 233. Sing Trust in Jesus. Thank you. my Father planned it all.
Thank you. Amen. Good evening. A blessing to be here. Blessing to have all our visitors in town with us. Praise the Lord. Good to have people traveling from all over to be with us. Amen. Well, I don't know if they came to be with us or with other people, but we're glad they're here, right? Amen. Okay. All right. Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Brother Carl, would you lead us in prayer?
Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for opportunities to fellowship together, hear your word spoken, just be in your house, be among people that share the same faith and desire to praise you and love you, Lord. Just thank you for that. Hearts through your word. Give us the guidance we need that we might go forward and be used of you. Bring glory to you, Lord, and to the people of your Son, Lord, the plan that you have for us. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. We're going to be in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 tonight, so if you'd go ahead and open your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And I was able to make up some tally sheets for you kids. If you want to play the game with us tonight, you can. You want to pass out some tally sheets? All right, good helpers here. Excellent. Been playing this game to help us in our listening skills, and adults can play too if you want to, but we've got prizes for those who listen the best. Now this one's a little different, okay, so let me explain the rules. All right, kids, if you hear a word in the sermon, you can circle it and then count down a tally. You know, remember how to do tallies, 1, 2, 3, 4, and then scratch through it for 5. And so do a tally next to how many times you hear it in the sermon. If there's some words on this sheet that shouldn't be in the sermon and won't be there, so you got to listen carefully, because you may circle a word thinking you heard it, but it wasn't in the sermon. So also, if there's a word like teaches, but on the tally sheet it just says teach, then that counts, okay? So any form of the word that you hear, okay, or teaching, that works too. And if you hear it when I read the verse, that doesn't count, because I can't count how many times I say it in the verses, because I don't have it all written down for my computer to count, okay? So if you hear it in the verses, that doesn't tally, okay? You don't tally that. But if you hear me say it during the sermon, then you can tally it, okay? All right, so those are the rules. So we'll see who's the best listener. All right, or best listener to both the rules and the tally words. Well, our text tonight, our reference text, is going to be in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, and we're going to read verses 1 through 34 eventually. So far in this letter to the Corinthians, the Apostle Paul has addressed some topics. Word got to him that there were some problems going on. He had spent a year and a half in Corinth teaching, and word got to him when he was in another town that, you know, hey, the Apostle Paul, there's some things going on here that you need to know about. And so he wrote this letter back to address these problems, these situations that were going on there in the church. And so, one of the things we looked at, there were divisions within the church, so he addressed that. There was the topic of marriage and purity within marriage. Another topic we looked at was the use of our liberties in Christ, so as not to be a stumbling block to the weak. And then we also looked at the use of spiritual gifts, a big section on that, and that those gifts are to be used for the edification of the church, not for self-glorification, but for the edification of the church. And then in the midst of that topic of spiritual gifts, there was the chapter 13 on love. And love needs to be the motivation for all that we do. because that will weed out the divisions. That will greatly keep our marriages and our purity in life and keep our marriages intact with love. It will also help us to understand the proper use of our liberties and not be a stumbling block to others because we love them. We want them to grow. And also it'll help us and it'll temper us in the use of whatever spiritual gifts and talents and opportunities that the Lord would give us. So really that is foundational in all of this. But we're going to get into a new topic tonight that is exciting. It should be very exciting for us as Christians. This instruction here is introduced because there is a new problem that we encounter here, the new problem that was there in the church. And the problem was what I'm going to call resurrection denial. There were some deniers in the church. Can you imagine being in a church where there were some of the members who didn't believe in the resurrection? That would be difficult. That's hard for me to fathom. How did they function like that? How did they, what happened when they taught about these things? And what was their vision of the future? That would be hard for me to imagine, but there it was. There was this problem in the church there. Some of them didn't believe in a bodily resurrection. They didn't believe it was possible. They questioned the doctrine. And I think this disbelief is corrected by the apostle pointing to the fact of Christ's resurrection. I mean, he didn't say, well, theoretically, this is how it would happen. He said, no, this is the facts. This is historically what happened, and these are the witnesses. And so he lays this out for us at the beginning of this chapter. Now, if you'll remember, when Paul was in his missionary journeys and he came down from Athens in Greece, he came down into Achaia, that's where Corinth was located. That's the region. And so prior to coming into Corinth, into Achaia, he had been in Athens and he had taught on Mars Hill. And when in Acts chapter 17 and verse 32, as he was teaching, and when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked and others said, "We will hear thee again of this matter." I mean, this was a laughing matter to them to hear about the resurrection. They didn't want to take this seriously. I don't know if it was just because of the Greek philosophers, because of the various abundance of gods that they had. Perhaps they had been influenced by the Sadducees. The Sadducees did not believe in the resurrection. In Acts chapter 23 and verse 8, for the Sadducees say that there is no resurrection, neither angel nor spirit, but the Pharisees confessed both. And so, whatever the influence, there were those there in that church that were deniers, okay? So let's begin reading in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, beginning in verse 1. "Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also ye have received, and wherein ye stand, by that which also ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain." I'll stop there and say this just for a second. That's a hard concept for me to understand, believing in vain. Because what we have to believe in is so solid. But there are people who will make a profession of faith. We've seen it. Perhaps it's happened to you. Make a profession of faith at some point, only to realize it's had no effect, that I wasn't truly surrendered in my heart to the Lord. So that there was a profession of faith, a belief, but it was in vain because it had no effect. There was no surrender to the Lord. There was no repentance, genuine conversion. And so I think there was some of this going on. Obviously, there was some of this going on in the church there. In verse 3, "For I delivered unto you first of all that which also I received, how that Christ died for your sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he was seen of Cephas, then of the 12. After that he was seen of above 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain unto this present, but some are fallen asleep. After that, he was seen of James, then of all the apostles, and last of all, he was seen of me also, as one born out of due time. For I am the least of the apostles, that am not meet to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God I am what I am. And this grace which was bestowed upon me was not in vain, but I labored more abundantly than they all, yet not I, but the grace of God which was in me. Whether therefore it were I or they, so we preach and so ye believed. We'll stop there for a minute. He's going to point out the importance of the resurrection here, and first of all, he starts with the fact of it. There's always been I should clarify. We can look back in various cultures through anthropology, and we can see that there is a belief in the afterlife in a great many cultures historically. We can look in the Egyptians, the Babylonians, American Indians, Hindus, Buddhists, Confucianists. They all believe in some form or another of an existence after death. And this is a key aspect of the doctrine of last things. Obviously, this is something we're looking forward to in the future, so it's going to be something that's going to play a large role in the last things as we study out what's going to happen, and we're going to see some of that tonight. The idea of the resurrection offers up a time for rewards and a time for judgments. It was preached, as the apostle points out here, it was preached by all the apostles. It was preached to the Corinthians, but some here had rejected it or turned away from it. Those who professed Christianity but they did not believe in the resurrection. They had believed in vain. If you don't hold to the resurrection, you've lost something. You've lost an important aspect. In fact, we're going to get into this. You'll see what it is you've lost. So let's look at the evidence here. First of all, it was foretold by the prophets. Who'd like to read Psalm 71 and verse 20? Do we have some volunteers here? Psalm 71 and verse 20. All right, Danielle, thank you. And how about Hosea 13 and verse 14? Wilhelmina, okay, Hosea 13 and verse 14. Then who'd like to read 1 Kings 17:22? 1 Kings 17:22, Brother John, thank you. And then who'd like to read 2 Kings 4:35? 2 Kings 4:35. All right, thank you there, Kaylee. And then finally, 2 Kings 13:21. 13:21, 2 Kings. Brian, okay. I thought Kimber was raising her hand. Wow, her arms got really big. But it's okay. All right. Just optical illusion there. All right. So let's start with Psalm 71:20. See that this has been prophesied from way before Christ came to this earth.
Thou, which hast showed me great and sore troubles, shalt quicken me again, and shalt bring me up again from the depths of the earth.
All right, shall quicken me again. That means bring me to life again. Hosea 13, 14.
The sorrows.
13 and 14?
Hosea, no, chapter 13, verse 14, yeah.
I will ransom them from the power of the grave. I will redeem them from death. O death, I will be thy plagues, O grave. I will be thy destruction.
Amen. We'll be redeemed from the grave. What a blessing. What a hope. And this is in Hosea, an Old Testament prophet, speaking of the resurrection. We've also got it in New Testament examples. We have the widow of Zarephath, 1 Kings 17:22.
And the Lord heard the voice of Elijah, and the soul of the child came into him again, and he reviled.
All right, so we have an example of resurrection there, a literal reviving, being brought back from the dead. The son of the Shunammite, 2 Kings 4:35. There we have another example of it. And then there was the man that was brought into contact with Elisha's bones, 2 Kings 13:21.
And it came to pass, as they were burying a man, that behold, they spied a band of men, and they cast the man into the sepulcher of Elisha. And when the man was let down and touched the bones of Elisha, he revived and stood up on his feet.
All right, so we have in these situations Old Testament examples that God can raise from the dead. We also have it in types. We have Jonah, 3 days and three nights in the belly of the fish. We have the type of Isaac being spared on the altar. And we have these Old Testament teachings and examples, but then we have those who were eyewitnesses. And it says first of seen of Cephas, then of the 12. So it's mentioning the apostles, first of all, not the women at the tomb. But so Peter, then the rest of the 12 saw him. Then they were seen by 500 at once. And then he was seen by James, and last of all seen by the apostle Paul in a special revelation that was given to him after his conversion. So the resurrection of Jesus Christ is one of the best documented events in the history of mankind, with this many witnesses, eyewitnesses testifying, and even a great many of them willing to go to the grave rather than to deny what they had actually seen. But yet there are those that would want to deny it. And even today, godly men preach this doctrine of the resurrection, and we receive it, and receiving it, it's part of the gospel, and through that faith, we have eternal life. Now, as we continue in our reading here, we're going to see the vanity of denying the fact of the resurrection. Beginning in verse 12, "Now if Christ be preached that he rose from the dead, how say some among you that there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there be no resurrection of the dead, then is Christ not risen? And if Christ be not risen, then is our preaching vain, and your faith is also vain. Yea, and we are found false witnesses of God, because we have testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he raised not up, if so be that the dead rise not. For if the dead rise not, then is not Christ raised. And if Christ be not raised, your faith is vain. Ye are yet in your sins. Then they also which are fallen asleep in Christ are perished. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most miserable." Despite the teaching of the Apostle Paul and the other apostles, there were some who denied the resurrection. And in doing so, they opposed the very gospel. The definition of the gospel is the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And they were opposing that. But he follows this line of reasoning and points out several absurdities and problems that result from denying the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Christ's resurrection was a promise of God in Psalm 49 and verse 15, but God will redeem my soul from the power of the grave, for he shall receive me. This was a promise of God. David believed it when his child died. 2 Samuel 12:23, he said, but now he is dead. Wherefore should I fast? Can I bring him back again? I will go to him, but he shall not return to me. And so he's alluding to a resurrection there as well. And Romans 8:11 tells us that if Christ arose, then so will others. But if the spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his spirit that dwelleth in you. So our hope rests in what Christ has done, what he's already done. If Christ didn't arise, then neither will anybody else. We preach all that's preached in relation to his rising from the grave would be in vain. I mean, it would be a lie. It would be false. I want us to think about this too. I'm throwing this in here. This is an added bonus. But if Christ didn't raise from the grave, there is no justice. There's no justice for anything. Let's go to Romans chapter 14. Romans chapter 14, beginning in verse 10. But why dost thou judge thy brother? Or why dost thou set it not, thy brother? For we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. For it is written, as I live, saith the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall confess to God. So then every one of us shall give account of himself to God. And then we read in Matthew 25, and verses 31 and 32, when the Son of Man shall come in his glory, and all the holy angels with him, then shall he sit upon the throne of his glory. And before him shall be gathered all nations, and he shall separate them one from another, as a shepherd divideth his sheep from the goats. We're all going to stand before the Lord, everybody, and give an account of themselves. Kids, do you, if you know you've done something wrong, and your mom says, or just does this, right? You know you're going to have to give an account. She knows what's going on, right? Come here. We got to talk. You're going to have to stand before God, who sees all things, knows the thoughts and intents of your heart, knows what you've done all your life. We are all going to stand before God. Acts chapter 17 and verse 31 says, because he hath appointed a day in the which he will judge the world in righteousness, by that man whom he hath ordained, whereof he hath given assurance unto all men, and that he hath raised him from the dead. When Christ rose from the grave, that's an assurance you're going to raise from the grave too, and you're going to stand before God. You're going to stand before Jesus Christ and give an account, who will be set as our judge. 2 Corinthians 5:10 says, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that everyone may receive the things done in his body according to that which he hath done, whether it be good or bad. So just remember, if there are bad things going on in this world and it seems like the perpetrators are not having to give an account, they're getting away with it, know that the justice is going to be served. The Lord says that we're not to take revenge, we're not to take out vengeance, because he said, vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. There's going to be a time when all the evils and all the wickedness and the unrighteousness of this world is going to be judged and cast away into the lake of fire for eternity. It's going to be settled. But there's the resurrection is when this is going to take place. Now, we're going to get into the timing of all of this in a little bit, Lord willing. But if there is no resurrection, there's no ultimate justice. And also, if there's no resurrection, then we are false professors. If there be no Christ, we don't have any hope of salvation. In John 8:24, he said, I said therefore unto you that ye shall die in your sins, for if ye believe not that I am he, ye shall die in your sins. If we don't believe that he has the power over life, and that he gave his life, and that he continues to live, we'll die in our sins. Let's look at our text here in 1 Corinthians 15 and look at verse 19. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most miserable. Think of the apostles who were persecuted and suffered and martyred for their hope in Christ. If there is no hope after this life, all that suffering, all that anguish, all that sacrifice, it's for nothing. It didn't amount to anything. There's no fruit to be born after this life. But the fact of the matter is, Christ is risen. We don't have to doubt it. There's witnesses. We don't have to wonder about it. We just know it because God's word tells us, and his witnesses have testified of it. They have given their lives as a testimony of the resurrection. Let's continue reading in verse 20. But now is Christ risen from the dead and become the first fruits of them that slept. That's good news, isn't it? That's hope. That's what we get excited about. I mean, that's why we meet every Sunday. Every Sunday is Resurrection Day for us, isn't it? I've told you this before, but in Russia, they have so many holidays for, you know, different saints, and, you know, every week the newspaper comes out with all of the holy days that the Russian Orthodox Church wants people to observe. And so we were asked over there, you know, you're a Baptist. Well, what's the most important holiday? Is it Christmas or is it Easter? And I said, it's the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and we like it so much we celebrate it 52 times a year. And it's just not just one day a year. It's the resurrection is we come together on that day that he rose. He has risen. In verse 21, for since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. But every man in his own order, Christ the first fruits, afterwards they that are Christ at his coming. Then cometh the end, when he shall have delivered up the kingdom to God, even the Father, when he shall have put down all rule and all authority and power, for he must reign till he hath put all enemies under his feet. The last enemy that shall be destroyed is death, for he hath put all things under his feet, but when he saith all things are put under him, it is manifest that he is accepted, which did put all things under him. And when all things shall be subdued unto him, then shall the Son also himself be subject unto him that put all things under him, that God may be all in all. So we've looked at the certainty of the resurrection. Now we're going to look more at the order of it, how it goes about, how the Lord has purposed that this should take place. Christ, in his rising from the grave, is called the first fruits. He's the one that came forth first. And we know that everyone shall be made alive. Every man, woman, and child shall be made alive again. Adam brought forth death, by which we die. Christ brings forth life, by which we live. But it says every man in his own order. So there's going to be a series of resurrections depending on what our relationship is with Christ. Christ first. Then at Christ's return, when he calls us up into the air, all believers that have died will be resurrected. Those that are alive will be caught up into the air, and those that have died, that are in the graves, they'll come forth out of the earth and meet Christ in the air. And let's go to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. We read about that. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Now, Christ is the first stage of this. Now we get into the second stage of the first resurrection. 1 Thessalonians 4, beginning in verse 14. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. That's a way of saying those that have those believers in Christ who have died will be caught up with the Lord. Verse 15, for this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. I mean, we're not going to hold them back, or we're not going to get there before they do. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout and the voice of the archangel and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then when we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. So this is still talking about what we call the first resurrection, Christ the first fruits, and then those believers, dead and alive, at Christ coming in the air. And after the tribulation, now when believers are taken off the face of this earth, we know that the Bible tells us there's going to be a 7-year period of tribulation, time of Jacob's trouble. But then the Lord will return to this earth and all his saints with him. And this, if we go to Revelation chapter 19, we'll read about that portion of it. And I'm calling this the third stage of the first resurrection, all right? Revelation 19, beginning in verse 6. We kind of went through this in our Sunday school class several months ago about end times. So this should be a little bit of a review. Revelation 19, beginning in verse 6. And this is a view in heaven. And I heard, as it were, the voice of a great multitude, and as the voice of many waters, and as the voice of mighty thundering, saying, Alleluia, for the Lord God omnipotent reigneth. Let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him, for the marriage of the Lamb is come, and his wife hath made herself ready. And to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen and clean and white, for the fine linen is the righteousness of saints. And he said unto me, Write, blessed are they which are called unto the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he saith unto me, These are the true sayings of God. And I fell at his feet to worship him. And he said unto me, See thou do it not. I am thy fellow servant. And of thy brethren that have testimony of Jesus. Worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. And I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and he that satteth upon him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he doth judge and make war. His eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. And he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with the vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, clean and white. So this talks about when we that have been taken up to meet the Lord in the air, and we have been with the Lord. In that time, while tribulation was going on the face of this earth, we will come back with him. That's still a part of our resurrection. And at the same time, those during the time of tribulation, there's going to be a lot of people who are going to be martyred for the testimony of Jesus Christ. It's going to be a tough time. And you talk about cancel culture, it's going to be, again, one of those times when you testify of Jesus Christ, that you believe in him, you're going to be canceled. In other words, you're going to be eliminated from the face of this earth. You're going to be martyred. And those that are martyred during the resurrection will come back to this earth in bodily form. Now, we know during the tribulation, they're going to be under the altar, and they're going to be saying, Lord, how long must we wait? And the Lord's saying, wait a little while, have patience. There's still more to come, but they're going to come back to the earth with the Lord. That's a part of this first resurrection. Then the Lord's going to establish his millennial reign for 1,000 years on this earth. And at the end of that time, now we get into what's called the second death. and the unsaved will be raised. This is Revelation 20, beginning in verse 11. And I saw a great white throne, and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life, and the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books, according to their works. Then the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell were delivered up, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them, and they were judged every man according to their works. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. I don't know exactly what form the people will have that are whose souls are in hell right now, what form their bodies will have, but this is, they're going to have to, we're all going to stand before the Lord, believers and unbelievers, and this is the time that it's called the second death, when unbelievers will stand before the Lord and be judged and ultimately cast into the lake of fire with all unrighteousness and all wickedness, forever to be banished from the presence of God and forever to have their influence removed from God's people. Now, I can let my imagination go wild, and I can try to picture what it's going to be like when death and hell comes back before the Lord, and the sea gives up what's in them, and the earth gives up what's in it, and I kind of wonder, this is going to be spookier or scarier than the worst horror movie you've ever seen, right? What form are they going to take? I don't know. Is this just spiritual? I think it has to be bodily in some form because they're going to suffer. But we'll find out when if you're saved and you get to watch this, or you'll find out if you're not saved and you have to go through it. I hope that's not ever going to be the case for anybody in here. But this is going to be a horrific time of judgment, and the anguish and the sorrow and the wailing for all of the unbelief that people will remain in. Now, death shall be destroyed at this point. Death will be no more. And according to the Bible, though, everybody has to be made alive again. This is a part of that resurrection. That's how it's all going to come together, everyone in their order, every man in his order. Well, we're going to close with this, because we're going to look at the influence of the resurrection. And one of the things, we'll look at this next week, and one of the things we're going to look at is the fact that baptism pictures the resurrection. And I'll just close with this thought. Studying for this lesson, it occurred to me, you know, when we baptize somebody, we have the water here. And as Baptists, we believe in immersion. Water shows the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ when we bring them up out of the water. If there was no resurrection, if we just showed the death and burial of Jesus Christ, there wouldn't be any Baptists. Let that soak in for a minute. Ha ha, get the pun? Okay, let that soak in. There would be no Baptists. We'd just hold them under the water till they are no more, right? Because there's no resurrection. Okay, you know, you made a profession of faith. Great, we get to drown you. No, there's a resurrection, so we come back up to walk in newness of life. That's the effect. The resurrection, for us, the effect is we have hope. And through repentance and faith, we too are buried, if you will, crucified with Christ, but we rise again to walk in newness of life by that Holy Spirit that is now dwelling within us when we trusted the Lord Jesus Christ at that moment of faith in Christ. All right, we will continue on with this next week, Lord willing. This ought to be contagious with us. The hope of the resurrection ought to be something that, you know, that puts COVID-19 to shame, right? I mean, this should be contagious in everything we do, that we have this hope, and we look forward to this, and that our hope is in what Jesus Christ has done for us. And so, as we look forward to this, it should just be bubbling out of us. It should be something that, you know, that the world just cannot suppress. It doesn't matter how much you load on us. It doesn't matter how much pressure we have. It doesn't matter the woes that we have. I really appreciated the song service as we started this, because with this on my mind, looking through the song service, this was woven throughout all of the messages of these songs that we sang. This is something that just, it's a great hope for us, and it is our life, even now. All right. Well, praise the Lord. We'll